Hi everyone, happy Monday from a breezy Southern California. The weather is definitely cooling off though. It's so nice to have weather in the 70s instead of the 90s like we were last week. So hope you guys had a great weekend and great to have everybody here. Today we're going to be talking about how to grow your own food no matter what the weather. We're going to talk about tips for bringing some of your plants indoors for the winter time. Now obviously you can't bring your whole garden in, but there's some really simple things you can do that you can grow inside and even bring some of your current plants that you have growing, hopefully, unless they've all gotten killed off by frost, to bring them indoors. So before we start though, I wanna say hello. I'm glad to have Santa Ana Road Wildman here. He's up in Central California. He works a lot of hours, so it's wonderful always to see him on his day off here. And he said, I see the zinnias behind you. Hope you're enjoying those. These were actually some of the Lilliput zinnias that I planted late in the season. A lot of my other ones are getting powdery mildew right now, but these ones are hanging on and we'll just leave them in as long as we can. So welcome, camera guys in the chat. Nisha and Cliff, our moderators, are in the chat like always, and appreciate all of you joining me on a Monday. Now I'm hearing from a lot of people in the pre-livestream chat, which in case you're new here, Cliff and Nisha are in the chat about half an hour before our livestream starts. I'm in the chat about a quarter till, about 15 minutes. But a lot of our pre-livestream chat viewers were saying that it's really windy. So I don't know if it's just a thing all across the country today. Cliff even said he had snow. Nisha got, I think she said 20 garlic cloves or bulbs planted. So a lot of people out there even bringing in their harvests from frosts that are going on, and Southern California people and Southern gardeners are enjoying the cooler temps. So really nice, pleasant time to garden here. One of my jobs for the week is to get outside and clear out a lot of the things that got killed off from the heat last week. So yeah, we're getting ready to plant a lot of our cool weather veggies. The weather is finally getting cool enough to do that. So let's see, Healing Berry Garden is here from Germany. I think it's probably 10 p.m. there, and she often joins us, I think almost every week, at the end of her day. She said their growing season is over. She's harvesting her butternut squash and bringing things in for the season. So great to have you here as always. And Terry Williams, great to see you here in California as well. Georgia Grow Guy, cheers, great to have you on here too. Ramona, watching from North Carolina. Eileen, walk the neighborhood for leaves, great idea, especially here with the wind. Okay, so let's jump in here, guys. And Rosalind, thanks for letting me know that some of the wind is from the hurricane in Mexico. So we've been out all weekend. I haven't even watched the news or looked at the weather to know there's a hurricane in Mexico, so I'll have to check that out. We actually had a really fun weekend. You guys have to go over to Camera Guy's Instagram at Cali Camera Guy. We went up to Central California with my sister-in-law and her husband, had a great time, went to a couple of wineries, went to one where they had a grape harvest festival, so it was really cool. We actually got to do a grape stomp, which was a lot of fun. We tried not to stomp too hard so as not to have grapes flying everywhere, but it was just a lot of fun. And Camera Guy did a beautiful short video over on Instagram. So do go over and check his Instagram out at Cali Camera Guy. Hurricane Rosalind. Okay, wow. Okay, I'll have to definitely check that out. There's tons of hurricanes this year, right? So hopefully everybody stays safe there if you're in the hurricane zone. Francine, hello from Jamaica. So good to have you here. People here from all over the world. So make sure you join us on Mondays. We always have a really, really good time together. Charlene, it was actually really fun. They just had big, huge bins, I guess they were, of grapes. And it was pretty mushy, but it was just a really, really fun experience to get up there. In the grapes, we were probably up to a little above our ankles. So it was pretty cool. Now, those were not the grapes that they made wine out of. They told us they fed those grapes to the pigs. So I'm sure they have pretty high cleanliness standards for wine. And I'm sure you wouldn't want to be drinking wine that a whole bunch of people stomped in. But it sure was a ton of fun. We really had a great experience. Okay, so I want to encourage everyone, no matter what the weather is, whether you're getting snow, frost, wind, whatever the weather is, if you think it's too cold to grow outside, you definitely can grow some of your own food no matter what, even all throughout the winter. You might not be able to grow it outdoors, but today we're going to talk about bringing some of your plants inside. Now, you definitely do want to kind of follow a little bit of a process when you do that, because there's lots of things that you might be growing outside that you don't want to bring inside. So I wanted to share about five tips today and what you could actually grow inside that would be really, really easy to do. So don't get intimidated by it. I'm not talking about bringing your 10-foot tall tomato plants indoors. I mean, you definitely could do that, but that's a little bit more challenging, and you have to have the setup for that, the grow lights for that. I really wouldn't recommend that. Even for an experienced gardener, that would be a huge, huge undertaking. So today we're going to be talking about very simple things that you can do even, you know, if you have a really busy life or busy schedule. So the first thing, why do we want to do this? Because we want to grow our own food. Whoops, my tripod, I think just about dumped over here, even though we've got it on a little weight here. It took a little spill with the wind. So look at some plants that you can bring in that might be damaged by frost or cold. And I'm talking things like, we'll talk about that in just a minute. We're talking about things like simple crops. For example, here we have a tiny Tim tomato. This I started from seed indoors and I've been letting it kind of grow to size outdoors in a little 1 gallon here. Or if you maybe already have a tiny Tim, you've been growing outside like in a 5 gallon pot, that's one thing you could bring inside and grow indoors during the winter time. This will need some grow lights to be able to grow and harvest tomatoes. But this is a very simple crop that you can grow indoors, or if you haven't started one yet, you can definitely get some seeds started. Another thing that I love to grow indoors in the wintertime is lettuce. So maybe have some little pots of lettuce. If not, get some started. And these are things that you can grow inside during the winter. One thing that is so easy to bring indoors is basil. So if you have a little pot of basil, here's camera guy. Came out to say hi. Need one more weight on here?
Yeah, I'm going to put another weight on the tripod there. Just wanted to say hi, everyone. Okay.
Everyone's saying hi. Basil and herbs are great things to grow indoors for the wintertime because it's so much fun to have fresh herbs growing on your countertop. You know, especially in the winter, you don't want to go out, like in a southern climate, maybe it's windy, rainy. You don't want to go outside to harvest herbs. But this one, basil, will not grow well in the cold winter months. If you live where you can't grow herbs outside in the winter, it's really fun to have just a small little simple herb garden on your windowsill. Some people like to grow peppers. I see that from Heidi, to bring your peppers inside. Peppers are really easy to overwinter. And if you don't want to grow them to the pepper stage, actually the fruiting stage, you can prune them, dig them up, put them in a container, and even put them in your garage or in a sheltered location. And I've got a video on how to overwinter peppers. Go back and check that out there. Okay, so when do you want to do this? You definitely want to bring in these cold sensitive crops. Well, lettuce is not a cold sensitive crop, but any other cold sensitive crops that you're going to overwinter inside as the weather is getting cold. So when you're dipping down below 40 degrees, it's a little bit on the chilly side for those. So that would be the time that you'd want to make that transition. We'll talk a little bit more about how to make that transition in just a moment. So definitely a few weeks before your first frost date, make sure you always are kind of keeping an eye on the weather, keeping an eye on thealmanac.com, the frost date calculator, so you know when your average first frost date is in your area. It's always a really important date to know for us gardeners. So you want to try and bring in, like I talked about, the plants I talked about, those are super easy crops to grow inside. And you want to bring in plants that are fairly healthy. So if you have a tiny Tim tomato that's been growing in a 5 gallon pot, maybe it's been growing all summer and it's just not looking so good, because tiny Tims are a determinate tomato and they will fruit, you know, usually over a month or two period of time. Tiny Tims can go for a long time, but then the plant starts to die. So I wouldn't bring in a plant that's, you know, bug infested or getting ready to die, because you want kind of a fresh new plant. So you can always plant new crops. The indoor garden seed collection is especially designed for indoor growing. Simple plants like the tiny Tim, microgreens, greens, and herbs that you can grow indoors. And you can grab this over at calikimgardeninghome.com. The sale this week, today's the last day of it, 15% off with the code CALIKIM15. So grab that today. Another thing I love to grow, and hopefully we'll be doing a video on this later in the week in more detail, is microgreens. You guys, I can't even tell you. I have about six or eight little pots of microgreens right now inside. And we just kind of, you know, snip them off, throw them in our salads, throw them in our soups, throw them in our scrambled eggs. And they just look so fun and vibrant growing, you know, indoors. And there's so many different types of microgreens you can plant. These are, I think, a red Russian kale. And my microgreen collection has, I think, 8 or 9 different varieties. So if you don't grow anything else, you don't want to bring plants in, just plant some microgreens, and you're going to be so happy that you did. They're really, really a wonderful thing to grow indoors. So that's basically the first thing of what you can grow indoors, when you want to grow it, and what you want to grow. So before we move on to actually how to do the process, let me jump into the chat. Let me know what you like to grow indoors, if there's anything you're planning on overwintering or bringing inside. And overwintering just means plants that you're going to grow over the winter. So if you've got some in your garden that you're planning on doing that with, let us know. I know there's tons of things that you could do indoors in the wintertime. So I'd really encourage you just to pick a couple, 2 or 3, 3 to 5, depending on how much space you have and how much time you have. But in those long winter months, you know, for the people who, especially people who have cold winters, it gets a little bit, you know, dreary to see the, you know, the cold winter, the weather, not be able to get outside. So I encourage you to get some things going now to kind of avoid that kind of the winter blues kind of thing there. Okay, let's see what is in the chat here today. And Tina, great question. Can you use the same seeds for outside for microgreens? Yes, you absolutely can. My microgreen collection just has some easy to grow varieties. So, but you can use the same seeds. It's not like a special seed or a special microgreen plant, and I'll give more details in the video we will hopefully shoot this week. They're just grown to a smaller size. So these are your regular kale seeds, that red Russian kale that you plant outdoors, but they're microgreens because they're planted a lot more densely. And they're harvested at about 2 to 3 inches tall. So basically all of the flavor, all of the nutrition, everything is power packed into these tiny, tiny little greens. So they're super flavorful, super high nutritional value, and they grow very, very quick. So red Russian kale, arugula is a great microgreen, radishes, even beets. And you could even do lettuce as a microgreen if you want to. I just planted some sunflower seeds for microgreens. Peas make great microgreens, but my microgreen seed collection has it all covered for you with 8 or 9, I forget which one, different varieties. So makes it super easy. And by the way, I think that maybe this may be on last week's live stream. I recently went to a farmer's market and the microgreens were $7 an ounce. Can you believe that? $7 an ounce, which might be, I don't know, maybe about this much if you harvested, I'm not sure exactly what, but you can plant like 8 or 9 different little pots of microgreens for just the cost of the seed collection. So definitely don't buy your microgreens, grow your own, and that way you can harvest them fresh every single day. So they really are a fantastic little thing to grow, a little crop to grow indoors in the wintertime. Nicole says, hi Nicole, how are you? I'm moving to my dream property. It's off grid and we'll be living in an RV for this winter. My plan is to grow some plants in the loft bed that has windows on 3 sides. Absolutely perfect. And microgreens would be perfect for you if you don't have much space like that. But congratulations too on moving to your dream property. I'm sure it's super exciting. And make sure you keep us posted here in the chat. How that's going. Very, very fun. Okay, a fresh tomato sandwich in early January is awesome. Yeah, it sure is. And the Tiny Tims do fruit indoors. I just use my regular grow lights with them. You know, I'm not going to get as much off it as I would if it was out in the full sun, but I definitely do get some tomatoes kind of just to keep you going, right? Okay, Barb says overwintering hot peppers, Jamaican sorrel, testing that, which is always fun to experiment. Brazilian starfish pepper, bell pepper plants, and after pruned, cleaned, new soil, and new pot, when bought in 3 weeks ago. Wow, Barb, you are going to town on that. So way to go. Definitely keep us posted on your progress there. So I'm really proud of you for trying some new things. It's always fun to experiment and try new things in the garden. Okay, let's get into the how to bring plants indoors. And this is really, really important. The first one is get rid of pests and prune, okay? And that is so important because when you bring your plants indoors, you know, outdoors, maybe they have some bugs, a few bugs on them. Don't bring in heavily infested plants. But if you bring those bugs inside, they can very, very, very quickly get out of control because we don't have the natural predators in the house that we do outdoors. So very important is, first off, is you want to get rid of pests and prune. So what I will do before I bring this tiny Tim tomato plant indoors is I will thoroughly douse it down with water. Just completely clean off the leaves. Make sure that there's no pests on the leaves. Yeah, exactly. That's exactly what I was going to talk about. Santa Ana Road Wild Man is talking about the leaves here. Is this one has a leaf miner. Where is that? I think it's right here. So anything that looks like this, see this little leaf miner on the leaf? I'm going to go ahead and pinch off. Do not want to bring that inside. These plants are yellowing down here, and I'm just going to go ahead. I think they might have a couple of leaf miners. You can see, guys can see how windy it is, right? They might have a couple of leaf miners on it, so I'm going to go ahead and pinch those off. So definitely prune off anything that is not looking good. Maybe I'll have one more here. So anything that's questionable, oh, there's one over here too. Anything that's questionable at all, take it off, all right? Even if you have to really prune the plant down to not too many leaves, go ahead and take them off. And of course, you want to always have a couple new ones going. So these are super easy to start indoors, like in a six pack. You can easily start them under grow lights, or if it's still warm enough, you know, pop them outside on your deck and start your seeds that way too. But I would probably just get some fresh new plants started as well, because a little six pack of tiny Tims, you can probably plant them out in a larger container in about 6 weeks, and then you're going to have some plants growing inside. So definitely prune them off. This one I actually am going to need to transplant into a 5 gallon. There might even be a few more on there, but this will do it for now. You guys got the idea. So I've pruned it, I've sprayed it down. I may even, like I mentioned, end up repotting this one in fresh mix before I bring it inside. And that's something that I always like to do if you're bringing things in, is just go ahead and get some fresh mix on it. So I could even pull this plant out, even just rinse out some of the old soil a little bit, like in a bin, and then pot it up with some fresh new seed starting mix that hasn't been sitting outside, so that I'm not bringing the pests indoors. So you always, always want to do that. Just inspect your plants very, very carefully, to make sure that you're not bringing the pests indoors. You definitely do not want to have an infestation. Okay, what you can also do is, you know, just kind of take this out and even just swish it around in a bucket of water, even just like dip it in, rinse out the soil, and that kind of thing, just to make sure there's no bugs there. And then what I like to do too is just spray the soil or spray the plant even with organic bug control. You can definitely do that with a neem oil, with neem oil and dish soap. So go ahead and look at my, I've got videos on how to control pests indoors, do the organic pest control method that we do outdoors. You can do the same for your indoor plants as well. So definitely make sure that you've got those pests under control before you bring it in. I think that's probably the most important thing, and the biggest thing that kind of holds up gardeners is they bring things indoors in infestation, and then it's a really big problem. So a couple other really cool things you can do to help with bugs inside. I have a video in our indoor garden series. So we have all kinds of videos on indoor gardening on pest control indoors. So it includes things like the little sticky traps, one of my favorites, putting little bottle caps of apple cider vinegar and dish soap. That works really well. Even pouring boiling water over your seed starting mix just to kill any fungus gnats. But there's lots of little ways that you can control those plants or those bugs inside before an infestation gets out of control. And I see people watching or talking in the chat here about rosemary. You can definitely do that. Rosemary will root very easily, and I've got a video on how to root rosemary. It is a very hardy herb. It will survive outdoors in some climates, or you can root it on your windowsill. You want to take a tender cutting. It usually will take a little bit longer to root than like a basil or a mint. But definitely that's a good one to have growing indoors as well. Okay, let's see in the chat here, any issues in your indoor garden with bugs? I know it's usually a big issue for most gardeners, including myself, if I don't keep an eye on it. Okay, oh, Connie, I'm so glad you asked this question. When you cut your microgreens to eat, will they grow back like cut and come again? Or will I need to replant new seeds each time? Okay, great question. And I'll cover this in our video we do on microgreens. You can cut them twice. I've had pretty good success with cutting them twice. The first harvest will be your biggest harvest, and I don't cut the whole thing at once because I just cut them as we use them. But after it's completely harvested, it will usually grow a second time, not as big of a harvest though. Usually get more growth, not near as thick. And then after I've harvested and cut the second time, I will pull out the stems and replant. You can definitely use the same soil. Because microgreens are harvested so quickly, they don't deplete a ton of nutrients. Yeah, Jerry's out here now fixing the umbrella because it definitely is getting a little breezier out here now. But you definitely can replant in the same soil. You might want to add a little bit of fresh mix to the top, but really because you're harvesting them within a week or two, they will definitely regrow in the same pot. And with these little 1 gallon smart pots, you can reuse them time and time again. I throw these in the wash, rinse out all the soil, throw them in the wash, and they're super handy. These I've been growing in for a couple of years, but just wash them up and they're literally as good as new. So they're really, really, really handy and nice and bright little color splash on your windowsill. So great question there. Okay, let me talk about number three, and that is set up a simple grow light station for your indoor plants. Now, a lot of you might already have your grow lights from the springtime that you use for your spring garden, so you might want to pull out a couple of those again. You might not need the whole entire big setup that you had in the spring, but just pull out a couple of them, set up a small indoor grow station. Or if you don't have one at all, again, don't let that intimidate you. So, so easy just to set up something small for your indoor garden. You can usually find the products that you need, the supplies you need at your local hardware store. One of my favorite, very, very simple ones, and we've got videos on how to get your grow light set up, is this one here. This is something you can clip to your countertop. Okay, for those of you that have never done it before, this is a little clip light that you can get at most hardware stores. And you do want to have a special grow light bulb for the inside. You don't want to use just a regular bulb you'd use in a lamp. And check out my video on how to set up grow lights. All the links are in there. And then what you can do with this is you can just clip it to your, like your cabinet or to a shelf, and then put your little pot of microgreens or your little tiny Tim. I actually usually do use these for my tiny Tims or my micros. And put your little plant right under there, and then you can move them up and down. I've attached some before to like milk jugs with a little PVC pipe in it, so you can move it up and down as the plant grows. It's super handy, and this probably costs, I think someone just said they found one at Walmart for $6 to $10. Yeah, $6 to $10, Santa Ana Road Wild Man, great. At Walmart, you know, any of your local hardware stores, and the grow lights you can find on Amazon. Again, check the links in the video description for that, because you do need a special grow light. So even if you just get one of these set up, at least you can have some little fresh herbs, your microgreens or your lettuce indoors. The microgreens actually you can grow on your countertop. If you have a windowsill that has some light, they don't need a ton of light because you're not growing them to the full size. These actually were under grow lights. They're pretty nice and uniformly grown, but you can put them on your windowsill even if you just have some indirect sunlight coming in, and they'll work just fine. They might get a little bit leggy, but it's no big deal because you're gonna be harvesting them within about a week or two. So do go ahead, get your little grow light station set up indoors, and that way you're gonna have a little splash of green on your countertop or on a shelf somewhere in your house during the winter time when it's a little bit too cold to grow outside. Okay, so we've got tip number one, tip number two, tip number three, grow lights. Let's head into the chat here and see what else is going on. And Santa Ana Road Wildman just put in a bright bulb. Look at the lumens and kelvins. Mine is not fancy. Absolutely. And all the lumens and kelvin are specified in that grow light video. Whoa, this umbrella. Hang on here, guys. It's a gale. Camera guy's out here helping me. Holding down the umbrella. All my stuff's blowing all over the place. Okay, can you grow basil from seed without a grow light? You know, I would probably invest in a grow light for that. If it's still warm enough, yeah, pretty crazy wind today. Gus, for sure. If it's still warm enough, you might be able to get some started outside on your deck or your patio or a shelf outside. But to grow from seed and to get it to grow well from seed indoors, I would definitely recommend a grow light. If you already have a pot growing though, or a plant growing, you can root a cutting. So this basil plant is from a cutting that I rooted, several cuttings actually. And if it's already established, it has a good root system, you can pretty much put this on a windowsill with some sunlight. Doesn't need a ton of sun, and it'll grow just fine. If you have a lot of sun, that's fine. But to get it started from seed, I would recommend a grow light. Okay, Santa Ana Road Wild Man, Kim and Rustic Garden have many indoor plant light setup videos. You don't have to buy the expensive plant lights or hydro type setups. Absolutely. There's so many expensive setups out there, but you can easily do it yourself for a fraction of the cost, and it's very simple really not that difficult to get set up. So highly, highly recommend that. Okay, End of the Gourd and Flower Farm says, Jerry, go hang on to Kim. She might blow away with the umbrella. He's literally out here standing on the umbrella in front of me. Okay, let's see what other questions we might have in the chat before we move on here to the next tip. And let's see, Andrea. We let our house get pretty cool in the fall and winter to conserve energy. Is indoor gardening still going to be effective, or at that point am I just basically overwintering? Andrea, I'd say it probably depends on what you're overwintering. The warm weather vegetables like the tomato and the basil, they will still do pretty well indoors because you're not going to obviously get freezing temperatures inside, hopefully not anyway. And as long as you know your temps during the day are in the 60s and 70s, they should do okay. Even if it gets pretty chilly, and they might not be quite as productive, you'll still most likely get some things out of them. But yes, the growth will definitely be slower. You may want to try a little mixture of both. Try your little pots of lettuce right there. Try some cool weather herbs like dill, parsley, cilantro. Those will do well in cooler temps. And get some of the cool weather veggies growing as well. Those are all the Fall Garden Seed Collection is a good one for that. The indoor garden definitely has some greens in there. Or even like one of the new collections I had, the specialty greens or the kale, those would do well indoors too, especially if you're keeping your house a little bit cooler. So give that a try. That was a really good question. Okay, number four for bringing plants indoors is to acclimate slowly, okay? So kind of like when we're hardening off in the spring, we're bringing indoor plants outside. When you're bringing your outdoor plants inside, you also want to kind of acclimate slowly because, again, they're used to the bright sun. They're used to, you know, just being outdoors in the elements. And it could kind of shock their system, again, if you just all of a sudden bring them in. So kind of do the reverse process. Bring them in for a few hours and then bring them back outside to get some sunlight and do it over probably a 3 or 4 day period is good enough. And make sure that you kind of baby them just a little bit when they get inside because they're going to have a different acclimation to, you know, the grow lights or a windowsill. They might end up yellowing or going into a little bit of a shock type of process, transplant shock, not really transplant shock, but indoor plant shock process. So just keep an eye on them, baby them just a little bit and do that process slowly. So one thing I found that does really help is the either the worm tea, the Vermistera worm tea, or the Vermistera Vitality. My plants get that almost every time I water them inside because it is a really gentle fertilizer. So they're not gonna get a huge burst of growth with that, but it's really gonna help their root development. It just basically helps them be healthier, helps them adjust to whatever it is that they're going through it really just helps them make that adjustment. So I would highly suggest that because it's very gentle and it's not gonna give them a huge, huge burst of growth at once. And it just generally keeps them all around healthy. So you can find a link for that in the video description. Okay, So yeah, there is a video out there on how to harden off your seedlings in our, I believe it's the First Time Gardener series. So just kind of watch that video and then do the process in reverse when you're moving them inside. So I'd like to hear in the chat here if anyone is in that process of moving their plants indoors and how things are going there with that. Okay, let's see here. Yeah, you don't want stinky fertilizer indoors. Yeah, I never do the fish fertilizer inside because that stuff smells and man, that'll just kind of stink up the house there. But the fish fertilizer, the good dirt plant food is another great one too to use indoors and it just works really well. So you definitely still do need to fertilize your plants inside. Just like you would outside, but maybe like once a week or so. Got a whole video on how to water and fertilize your indoor plants to really help keep them healthy. Okay, and Roslyn, great feedback there. Vermistera as a foliage spray helped a lot with my leaf miner. Okay, really good feedback. Yeah, you can just pop in the worm tea or the vitality into a spray bottle and keep that around in the indoor garden as well. And even when you're, if you're like spraying your microgreens before they've germinated, that makes for a great foliar spray. And plants really absorb the nutrients very quickly through their leaves. So that's a really good thing to do for your indoor plants and your outdoor plants as well. Okay, Rob is asking, can I grow tomatoes in the winter time in Central Florida outside? You know, Rob, it really depends on your temperatures there. I don't know if Central Florida gets frost, if you have cold temperatures there. Tomatoes are a warm weather vegetable, so they're gonna do best when the nighttime temps are in the high 50s. And in the 60s, the daytime temps are in the 70s, 80s, 90s. So it really just depends on your temperature. But a lot of times here in California, I can overwinter one or two plants. They won't be as productive, but I can usually get a few tomato plants to grow outdoors all winter, even though we do pretty consistently get into the 40s in the wintertime. Occasionally we get a frost. So my best suggestion to you is just experiment with one or two plants, see how it goes. I know that I do have pretty good success with the Tiny Tims for most of the winter. Because they're smaller plants, they don't take quite as long to go, they don't need quite as much sunlight to go from seed to harvest. So these are a great little plant to grow outside in the wintertime in southern climates. So you may want to give that a try. You can grab seeds from these in my indoor collection, my container collection, and get some started now. Okay, let's see here. See, Gina, oh, this is also something I meant to mention, Gina, so I'm glad that you mentioned this. Over here, it's crazily warm for October. My lemon tree punched its leaves in my face when I tried to take it inside. Yeah, be careful with that one, right? And that does bring up a really good point, is that citrus, if you live in a cold winter climate and you have citrus in containers, it's a good time before it's too cold to bring them indoors. A lot of times they'll do really well by a sunny window, and you pretty much would follow the same process that I just shared about making sure that the leaves are cleaned off, there's no pests, cleaning off the soil, doing a little organic pest control on them before you bring them inside, and then do a little bit of research on how much light they might need, and you may even need to put a supplemental grow light in. But if you have a nice sunny window, they should do okay in that, and then bring them inside or back outside once things start to warm up. Okay, Nicole, how you doing, Nicole? It's going to be an adventure for sure. I love camping and the outdoors, so I'm super excited. The build and shaping the new property is going to come in phases. So that's for your dream house. Definitely keep us posted on that. I'm super, super excited for you. Okay, have you heard of this is from Diversity, let's see where that comment go. Diversity Love, have you heard of a Wallapini, a naturally controlled climate greenhouse? No, I haven't. That would be kind of fun to look more into that. So you have to keep us posted if that's something that you're doing. Greenhouse growing. We don't tend to do a lot of greenhouse growing here because it just gets too warm. Then my plants get too overcooked in the daytime, even in the wintertime. So we don't do a whole lot of that. But if you do that, let us know how things go. Okay, we do have one more last tip I'm going to share before we sign off of our live stream, and that is about watering. Don't overwater your indoor plants. I think a lot of gardeners are kind of prone to overwatering. I know I am, because it's usually the thing when my plants start not looking so good, I just tend to like, oh, maybe they need some water, and give them some water, which can be a little bit more easily controlled outdoors. But inside, when you're in containers, really try to resist the urge to overwater. And the reason why is when you overwater, it tends to bring on all kinds of things like mold, mildew, fungus gnats. All different types of pests can grow more in the soil when it's wet and damp. So let your plants dry out just a little bit. These actually were out in the wind, so they're kind of getting dry, but usually I like to let the top few inches of my soil dry out a bit. Just because the top is dry doesn't necessarily mean that your plant needs watered. So let the top few inches dry out and then only water when your plants actually need it. So do the little finger test where you're putting your finger in the soil. And yeah, this one, you can see how dry and kind of flaky that soil is. These got a little bit too dry. We were gone for a couple days and they dried out. But what you always want to do is water your plants from the bottom, especially your indoor plants. So you can stick your plants in, a storage tub of water, even like a cookie sheet if you don't, have a storage tub on the indoors, and water them from the bottom. Fill up the bottom of the tub with water. Add a few drops of the Vermistera, any of the fertilizers, the Vitality or the Worm Tea, and let the water kind of wick up from the bottom. And then once it's pretty well saturated and your plant feels a little bit heavier, you can take it out, put it in a little drip tray, and then just keep repeating that process whenever it needs water. But generally for me, indoors, depending on how warm it is, I do check them every couple of days. They might need water once or twice a week. So it really does depend on the temperature inside your house. So if you've got the heater going, things might dry out a little bit quicker. If it's a little bit cool in your house, they might not dry out as quick. So really do pay attention to it and check your indoor garden every day or so, and do only give it water when you need to. So let's see here. Oh, and do make sure and go back and watch the video on watering and fertilizing your indoor garden. There's a lot more details in there. And by the way, just so you know, if you have a question, always go and use the search function on our YouTube channel, because a very good chance that we could have a video on that, and it could help get your question answered and get you growing and harvesting and eating your own vegetables a lot quicker. Okay, so that's 5 tips to bringing your outdoor plants in and growing vegetables or some type of crop indoors all winter. And what I want you to do this week is look around your garden, see if you have any healthy plants that you can bring indoors. If not, pick 3 to 5 or 2 to 3, depending on how much time and space you have, to grow indoors in the winter. And next week when we come back, I'd love to hear about what you're going to grow inside, so that we're not hitting the winter blues in a month or two because we don't have anything growing. So start now. You're going to be really, really happy that you did in another month or two. Okay, let's see what questions or comments we have in the chat before we sign off. Hope you're inspired by today's live stream. And let me know what questions you have in the last few minutes of the chat. Okay, Terry, great question. Do you need to feed indoor plants more often or less than when they're outside? Usually what I do, Terry, is my indoor plants in containers, even outside, I feed them about outside they usually go for about every 2 weeks. Inside I probably feed them about once a week. So usually I have smaller containers inside. The water's draining out fairly quickly. So just to keep them, going along, moving along, growing along healthily, I'll water them with my liquid fertilizer about once a week. And you can just do that on your regular watering session. So when your plants dry, go ahead and give them some fertilizer at the same time that you water them. Okay. Sorry, if I were to buy seeds online to save for next year to plant outdoors, would they get old? Okay, great question. And the answer is no. Seeds are viable for a couple of years as long as they're stored properly. So if you buy my seed collections now, they're going to be good for a couple of years. I usually store seeds in a cool, dry place. You want to make sure that there's no moisture getting in. I have some like in a cabinet inside in my living room, and that's a perfectly fine place to store them. I personally don't store seeds in the refrigerator or the freezer. I just don't have enough space for that. I know some people do that, but usually in a, coolish, doesn't even have to be that cool, just mainly a dry place, and a place that's not just getting blasted by sunlight. They're going to be great for a couple of years, so perfectly okay to do that. Okay, should we be prepared to show our progress next time? Well, it's a little bit hard to show your progress here on the live stream, but I definitely would love to hear about it. And if you post on Instagram, definitely make sure you tag myself or Camera Guy at Kelly Camera Guy. And we can definitely take a look at your photos online, or you can email Kim at kellykimgardeninghome.com. So great question there. We would definitely love to see your progress. Okay, let's see here. Santa Ana Road Wildman, really good tip. Use those packs of do not eat drying agents that come in shoe boxes or vitamins to keep your seed dry. Okay, I love that. I always wonder what to do with those little things, like those little silica packets. So really good suggestion. Love that. Julie, is it too late to plant or transplant peonies in the north? You know, I grew peonies my mom grew peonies growing up, but I've never grown peonies myself. So I think, actually, I'm not even going to say, because I'm not even sure about that. So if anyone has any experience with that, please pop in the chat here and do some research and let us know on that. And End of the Road Gourd and Flower Farm says, I store my seeds in envelopes on top of my kitchen cupboard. So great, great tip for that. That would definitely help absorb any moisture that might be in them. You can store them in paper bags. You just definitely don't want to store them anywhere where there's any humidity and it could damage the seeds. Okay, guys, I think we're gonna sign off for today. Thank you so much for joining us. It's been a ton of fun. Make sure you come back next Monday, because we live stream every Monday at noon Pacific time for lots more garden tips and tricks. And you can see daily or a couple times a week garden tips and tricks over at Kelly Kim on Instagram. Make sure though that you do follow Kelly Camera Guy, because he has tons of fun videos. I guarantee it, when you check out his Instagram, you're gonna laugh. Woo-hoo. And great, he's holding the umbrella, or he'd be here on screen with me. But little video from our weekend. He's Kelly Camera Guy over on Instagram, and it's always a fun time over there as well. So have a great week, guys. We'll see you on next week's live stream and a few videos in between.
Bye. Bye-bye. Everyone.
And Jerry says goodbye too, if you didn't hear that. Have a good week.